what she would like me to do tonight, and she said, be brief. She said it's three B's that she's learned in her life. One is to be brief, be sincere, and be seated. Don't take too much time. And when she reminded me of that, it reminded me actually of a true story. I always think the best funny stories are the true stories. And I was, this is a true story. I was honored, quite frankly, to be the speaker at a commencement of a college. And at that commencement, I was also told, please be brief. And so, in order to be brief, I took with me to the speech an alarm clock. And I got up for the speech, and I put the alarm clock up in front of me. It's a true story. And I said to the students, I said, I'm going to set this alarm clock at 12 minutes. And when the alarm goes off, I'm going to stop speaking. I'm going to sit down. And you're going to get your diplomas. And then we're all going to go down to the elbow room and drink beer. And of course, you could just imagine. They just erupted and thought that was a wonderful idea. The problem was, is I only spoke for 10 minutes. And I went, I sat down, but I forgot the alarm clock. And the president of the college got up and started to speak to get into the whole process of giving them their diplomas. And the first thing, of course, that happened when he got up to speak is the alarm went off. And as soon as the alarm went off, the students erupted again. and it was really kind of a interesting time. I really like the setting. Thank you, Gloria. Thank you for setting this up. I don't know if you looked at the sign in front of the church before we came in. The sign outside the church said, tired of sin, come on in. and somebody had etched below it, if not, call 486-234. It is indeed a pleasure to be here. We've got, and I'm hopefully in the interest of time, I'll be able to cover some of the things we have to talk about somewhat quickly. Some of you will have heard part of this before. What I'd like to do tonight is a little bit of a review on the so-called methodology that we use to, first of all, make good investment decisions, but also the methodology we use that you could use, or anybody could use, to make good business decisions. A little bit about the methodology, and that's important. Then I'm going to go on and I'm going to talk about what the current financial markets, as well as economic variables, tell us as far as the current cycle. I'm going to try to quantify it. Hopefully I can go through that quickly. And then I'm going to get to some of the issues that really face us, some of the bigger issues that face us today. Now, that's an awful lot to cover, so I'm going to be going fairly fast. Some of this is technically a little bit difficult for me as well, but don't worry about it. Just try to, shall we say, hang in there. Good evening. Okay. The first thing is the most important question, I think, the most important question we face as both investors as well as business people has the current cycle, a cycle which consists of three parts, a stock market cycle accompanied by a business cycle accompanied ordinarily by an interest rate cycle, has the current cycle come to an end? And therefore, our principal investment objective, as well as the way we run a business, needs to change from capital appreciation to the preservation of capital. In the immortal words of Gerald Ford, the American presidency's answer to Yogi Berra, as the pendulum come full circle. So that's the first question, really, and the whole purpose of the methodology, which I've been working on for years, is to try to answer very important questions of that sort. The methodology really consists of some very simple steps, And again, for those of you that have heard this before, I apologize, but it's important perhaps in the sense of just reviewing it, because we're going to be spending some time on these kinds of issues. The first step in the methodology is not that. The first step in the methodology is to get up in the morning. First step in making a healthy forecast for where the financial markets and the economy are going is to get up in the morning and go and look in the mirror and confess that you don't have a clue where the stock market's going and you don't have a clue where the economy is going. The second, third, and the fourth steps are a little bit more rational. The second step is to identify meaningful trends that are unfolding in the financial markets. And by meaningful, I mean those are the trends that have been unfolding for a long enough period of time that, based on financial market history, there's a reasonably good chance that they could continue. So identify important trends or meaningful trends that are unfolding in the financial markets. The next step is to identify meaningful trends that are unfolding with important monetary and economic variables. The whole purpose of that second step, really third step, is to determine if the second step is rational. Are the trends that are unfolding in the financial markets rational, or are they consistent with a rational forecast for the economy and earnings, inflation, and interest rates? And then if the two agree, then what you do is position portfolios or make business decisions to participate in those trends. And then the next step, which I'm also not supposed to tell you, is you go to church like this and you pray that those trends are going to continue. The whole purpose of this methodology really is to determine where you are in the current cycle. And as I said before, the current cycle consists ordinarily of a stock market cycle, a business or economic cycle, followed by ordinarily an interest rate cycle. If you can identify this cycle has occurred with enough regularity in the post-war period, we are now on our 11th cycle, has occurred with enough regularity that you can be very confident that the cycle is going to recur or is going to continue. Interesting thing is that the financial markets, on the one hand, and the economic and monetary variables, on the other hand, perform in very specific ways at the beginning, the middle, and the end of the cycle. So if by identifying meaningful trends in financial markets or identifying meaningful trends in important economic and monetary and economic variables, you can tell where you are in the cycle, then making good investment decisions, especially that very important investment decision, asset allocation, percentage of your portfolio that you're going to allocate to equities, the percentage you're going to allocate to fixed income securities, making those decisions becomes easier. Not easy, but easier. So we'll spend a little time on that. Once you've done that, though, you're really not finished. And this, I have to add, and it sometimes tends to confuse, but nevertheless, you have to add this. You also have to know that if in case you have gone through a major mania, you have to understand a little bit about manias, because if you're going through a mania, where you are in that mania will impact the underlying cycle. So you need to know a little bit about manias. There are four stages, and again, some of this is review. Four stages of a typical mania. First, the stage of investment. You buy a house to live in it. The second stage is the stage of speculation, where investors become speculators. The stage of speculation characterized by the emotion of euphoria. Investors become speculators, and they borrow money to buy assets, a second, third, and a fourth home, or their first home in Nevada for $750,000 after they've moved out of a trailer, to buy an asset at a price that's arguably overvalued, borrow money to buy an asset at a price that's arguably overvalued with the hope, the dream, or the fantasy that it's going to become even more overvalued. As I've said before, prices don't go up forever and ever, except in the sales presentations of investment bankers. Charles Kindleberger, Galbraith once said, the recurrent lapses into financial dementia have not changed in any real way since the tulip mania of 1636 and 1637. As Charles Kindleberger, his protege, MIT, said, there is nothing quite so disturbing to your well-being and good judgment as to see a good friend get rich. This leads to this monkey see, monkey do type of environment, and therefore a continued or ongoing speculative rise in prices. We're now in 2004, 2005 of the, maybe the first part of 2006 of the housing debacle or mania. The period of speculation, the defining characteristics of a period of speculation are leverage and rising prices. That's followed by a period of financial distress when prices start to level off. The investors who have become speculators begin to have difficulty making their debt service payments. Some do not and default. 2006, 2007. Investors start to have difficulty making their debt service payments, do not, some don't default. And most importantly, the lenders who finance the speculation begin to back away from the markets. The lenders being banks start to back away from the markets, sell their mortgages, offload their mortgages, securitize their mortgages, and offload them to innocent investors such as the New York Common Retirement Fund, where I am an advisor and saw it happen. At any rate, so they try to offload or they try to back away from the markets. That's followed by the period of revulsion. In the period of revulsion, there's a prices are declining, and that's, of course, characterized by a veritable race for the exits, somewhat similar to what you saw in the bond market last week. Veritable race for the exits as investors who have become speculators try to get out of the markets, and the lenders who finance the speculation try to sell their mortgages or get out with their skins. I've mentioned to you before that it's during the stage of revulsion that there's the revelation of the swindles and scandals that occurred during the period of speculation. Bernie Madoff, the revelation of those swindles and scandals, as Kindleberger so correctly says, the urge to swindle and the urge to be swindled runs parallel to the urge to speculate. There's a sucker born every minute, little Dorrit. So that stage of revulsion, I think the contribution, which is interesting in this, is the contribution that's recently been made, and this is new, by Rogoff and Reinhart, two professors at Harvard, who are controversial, but nevertheless are professors at Harvard, which is part of what makes them controversial. But they have done an analysis of all of these kinds of cycles, the manias, and learned, very importantly, that these the revulsion stage of the mania lasts a lot longer than anybody can expect or expects. The average duration being 6 years. And this is now 2007 through essentially today, you might say today, where the revulsion period has been somewhat ongoing. It's during the stage of revulsion that we attempt to eliminate or cut back on, reduce the excesses that were built up during the stage of speculation. And in this case, of course, we're talking about primarily mortgage debt. So we try to eliminate those excesses. And the whole process of trying to deleverage is the word you'll hear, can be have a major impact on the economy. If you're asking the question, is it the Obama administration is the reason why there's been such slow growth or unusually slow growth in the economy, such unusually slow growth in employment or recovery in an economy, and quote, it's not the Obama administration. It's the fact that we're coming out of a housing mania. We're in the revulsion stage. We're in the process of reducing all the leverage that was built during the 2004-2005 stage of speculation has nothing to do with the current administration. In fact, they've done lots of things to try to relieve the situation. They, to some extent, but certainly Chairman Bernanke has done a lot of things and correct things. Let's take a look at where we are now or what the situation looks like now. What is the what are the meaningful trends that are occurring or unfolding in the financial markets? That's got last week or a couple of weeks ago in there. The trend in the stock market for the year is up 13.5%. I think you have to conclude that, especially based on what's gone on this week, the trend in the stock market is up. Now this you can't see, but what this says is this puts all of the various sectors, lists the various sectors in the order of performance. And what it says is that on balance, investors have been migrating to the so-called bull market or riskier sectors of the market and away from the safer sectors of the market. Safer sectors like consumer staples, which includes household products, foods, safe things, things that everybody buys, continues to buy, toothpaste, which most of my friends buy, but not all of them. But consumer non-cyclicals, healthcare, utilities, and telecommunications. It's really an ambiguous picture this year. Some of the bull market sectors, the economically sensitive, high beta, more risky sectors of the market have been the best performers, but then there's been some of the less risky, the safer sectors of the market have also been. So let's just say the performance of the stock market, the performance of sectors is a little bit ambiguous, and that's important. The next thing is small capitalization stocks, that's 15%, 14%, 11%. The bottom one shows large capitalization stocks. You can't see it, but small capitalization stocks have outperformed large capitalization stocks. Again, evidence that investors are willing to take risk. The next is that longer-term interest rates have been rising, needless to say, from 1.90 in December of 2012 to 2.53. This is not a surprise to anybody, but remember, stock market cycle, business cycle, interest rate cycle. So. That, again, is evidence of that we're maybe further to go in the current cycle. This is the yield curve. This is a little bit technical, and I'm not going to go into it because it can get terribly boring. And if you don't go to sleep, I'll probably go to sleep. So let's not talk about the yield curve. But the yield curve is steepened, and the steepening of the yield curve, again, is evidence that investors have become somewhat more optimistic about prospects for the economy in 2013 and 2014. Quality spreads is measured by the difference between the yield on a corporate bond, a BAA corporate bond in this case, and a 10-year U.S. Treasury, safer 10-year U.S. Treasury. Quality spreads have narrowed until recently, although they come back down a little bit. But quality spreads have essentially narrowed, again, evidence that the investors are willing to take greater risk or that they're becoming more optimistic about prospects for the economy. The same thing is true not just of BAA corporates versus 10-year treasuries, but also junk bonds versus 10-year treasuries. So the message on balance, and I say that emphatically, on balance, because there is some ambiguity here that you need to think about or that we have to think about. But the message of the financial markets on balance is that the economy is going to continue to expand through 2014, which is essentially a way of saying that we have further to go in the current cycle. The question is that consistent with important monetary and economic variables? My answer to that question, and again, if you have any questions or you're puzzled, just go ahead, fire away, because I don't want to leave you without you understanding what we're talking about. But anyway, the signals, the monetary and economic signals that ordinarily signal further to go in the current cycle are pretty much in place. I'll go through them quickly. Federal Reserve policy, to say the least, at least now, remains very accommodative. And we'll talk about Federal Reserve policy in a little bit. In response to that, Federal Reserve policy being accommodative, bank lending continues to improve or grow. Total bank lending, total commercial bank lending, improving or rising. Lending to businesses also has improved tremendously. So lending to business is growing. Lending for financing real estate transactions is barely growing, but nevertheless is now positive after being negative for so long. In response to the rise in bank lending, the money supply is growing. In a word, there is enough liquidity to drive both the economy and the financial markets. Ordinarily, when there's enough liquidity to drive both, when these when this ratio, it's a technical ratio, is positive, ordinarily it's associated with positive growth in the economy and positive growth or rise in stock prices. Because bank lending, because liquidity conditions are positive, leading indicators for the economy, indicators that tell us where we're going, not where we've been, have been rising. They've been rising 5 of the last 6 months, 9 of the last 12 months, and they also are indicating that the economy is likely to continue to expand through 2013, 2014. This is one I've talked to you about before. It's just the ratio of coincident economic indicators to lagging economic indicators, a ratio of how the economy is doing today compared to how the economy was doing, say, 6 months ago, ratio of coincident to lagging indicators, and therefore, as such, is kind of a measure, if you think about it, of the momentum in the economy. Now, I don't know why I throw, I've also said this before. You know what you get when you cross a godfather with an economist. You get an offer that you can't understand. And when we start talking about stuff like this, when we talk, that's why you get jokes like that. The truth is the leading indicators are telling us the economy is going to continue to expand. This composite is telling us that although the economy is going to continue to expand, that it is indeed losing some momentum, and that's what we have to pay particularly close attention to. So the message of the financial markets collectively, but with some ambiguity, is that we have further to go in the current cycle, that the message is further to go in the current stock market business interest rate cycle, and that seems to be consistent with some, if not all, important monetary and economic variables that I follow. What I'm going to do real quickly now is to quickly quantify what I think will be the outcome. I want to quantify what I think the outcome will be for the economy, employment, consumer spending, and importantly, short-term, long-term interest rates, and also stock prices. First of all, the starting point for such a forecast could be my forecast, but I prefer to use, my forecast is much different than this, but I prefer to use the consensus forecast for the economy as measured by blue chip economic indicators. There are two really services that really do a good job of surveying economists to try to determine what's the consensus for what lies ahead for the economy. And one is blue chip economic indicators, which is very good, and Bloomberg is the other one. So, let me go back to this. As you can see, we're talking about 1.9% growth this year, accelerating some to 2.6% growth in 2014. That, of course, is very consistent with the performance of the financial markets. And as you can also see, is that gross domestic product rises somewhat as we go through the forecast period. The growth rates get better and better. It's also the case that inflation is fairly low, and that's a concern to the Federal Reserve and should be a concern to everybody here. That's an important issue. But inflation, hopefully, thankfully, at least if the forecast is right, rises through the forecast period up to 2.2% by the fourth quarter of 2014. This is one of my favorite charts because, and it's a little hard to explain what it says, but what it says, it shows the consensus forecast, which is the line, the red line, for 2013. And it also shows the tendency of the consensus forecast tends to pull towards the outcome. It either starts too high and has to come down through the forecast period, or it starts too low and has to go up through the forecast period. But the difference between the consensus and the final outcome tends to be fairly wide as we start the forecast period, and then it narrows, of course, and gets to almost zero at the end of the forecast period, but then they have all the numbers. So then it's going to equal it. But you can see that it tends to pull in one direction. And the consensus forecast for 2013, now 1.9%, is declining, which suggests that that consensus, which I just showed you, is probably going to turn out to be a little bit high, or is going to come down more as we go through the rest of this year or the rest of this forecast period. I don't think it's going to zero, but it's going to come down just a little bit, maybe 1.6 from 1.9. Okay, employment. What this says is that employment is going to, if the consensus forecast for the U.S. economy is correct, employment conditions are going to continue to improve throughout the forecast period. The average, what's really interesting, well, both of all of it's interesting. See the unemployment rate coming down to 6.4% in the fourth quarter of 2014. And the average monthly change in non-farm payroll employment, the last one was 165,000. The average monthly change in non-farm payroll employment will be 292,000 by the fourth quarter of 2014. What this says, yeah. How accurate is it? It's a great question. The question is, how accurate is it? Especially when a lot of people have essentially dropped out of the labor force and are no longer looking for jobs. And the answer is, like any forecast, who knows? But is it for, the numbers are, in my judgment, statistically consistent with the forecast for the economy. And what you're likely to see is maybe it won't be that strong, but it's, these numbers are not outlandish. They're shared by a lot of forecasters. What you're likely to see is growth, but it might not be as strong as is indicated up there. So you raise a good question.
That would probably indicate that businesses are opening up their walls, wouldn't it?
Not really. You'd be surprised. 292,000 is not a big number. Well, it's a big number, but it's certainly better than what we're seeing now, but that's about 100,000 more per month than what we're seeing now. It sounds like a big number, but I think it's. The one interesting thing is it says, what these numbers say is that by the end of 2013, we will have recovered 7.6 million of the 8.6 million jobs we lost during the crisis. 7.6 of 8.6 at the end of 2013, and at the end of 2014, we will have recovered all 8.6 million jobs that we lost, plus another 2.3 million. Now, I spoke to you guys, you folks, a couple years ago, and I told you numbers roughly like this, and we're on that path towards those numbers being right. Yes, sir. Let me clarify what the Fed said. The Fed said, and you're right, you're pointing to employment conditions. You should also point to inflation conditions. But the Federal Reserve said that if employment and inflation, without being specific, if employment and inflation conditions improved, they would begin to taper or reduce their purchases of securities, treasuries, and agency-backed securities to, from the current level of $85 billion per month, maybe to zero by the middle of 2014. That's called quantitative easing, which essentially they're saying we're going to reduce our commitment to quantitative easing. Okay, that's one thing. The second thing that's important to understand about Federal Reserve policy is their interest rate policy. Interest rate policy means their target for the federal funds rate, which is currently 0 to 25 basis points. There are two components of Federal Reserve policy. Quantitative easing, which is designed primarily to keep intermediate to longer term interest rates low, among other things, low and attractive, and interest rate policy or federal funds rate policy, which is designed to keep the federal funds rate low. It's quite possible Now, the question is, what are the conditions under which they would start to taper or reduce their commitment to quantitative easing? Nobody knows. The answer from a number of members of the Federal Reserve, former governors, is that when you see 2 to 4 months, successive months, of increases in non-farm payroll employment of 200,000 plus per month. Okay, that's fine. Well, you start to see that, as you can see, in the third quarter, the third quarter of the current year and the fourth quarter of this year. As a guess, therefore, as most people's guess, as certainly bond buyers' guess, is that the Federal Reserve will begin to taper or to reduce their commitment to quantitative easing starting in the third quarter, but most likely the fourth quarter of this year, and they will stop or they'll do no longer purchases of treasuries and agency back by the end of the first half of 2014. So that's one part of Federal Reserve policy. The second part of Federal Reserve policy is their interest rate policy, and that is their target for the federal funds rate. When will they change their target or raise their target from the 0 to 25 basis points, or essentially 0% on the federal funds rate? That they've been very specific on. They said when the unemployment rate gets to 6.5% and prospects for inflation get to 2.5%, 2 to 2.5%. And you're quite right that we start to get there, 6.4, 6.6% at the end of 2014. So the guess is that starting in the first quarter of 2015, it's not only going to be the case that QE3 will be long gone, but it's also going to be the case that the Federal Reserve will start to raise short-term interest rates in the first quarter of 2015. Nobody knows. My guess is maybe the second half of 2014. And they said that India, for example, which at the time had been a substantial net importer, had a large and growing population, a large importer of food, would be part of the issue as well as China. Well, there were some technology innovation in India, and India shifted from being an importer of food to being an exporter of food. What were the technology innovations? Two. One is they created carts with wheels that could get the product from the farms to warehouses. And the second thing is they created warehouses which would preserve the food. Now, you and I would solidly say that doesn't sound like technology, but it was at the time. So what I'm just simply saying is don't underestimate technologies. Now, let me show you. I'm gonna have to go to, but don't understand the ability of technology to solve problems. For example, I had some numbers up here on oil. And this is, I was going to go through, all rel constructed, the hell. On oil. And I really probably should go to them. They're a long ways away. But, wow, what a change. Okay, this is my normal forecast that I make once a year on the price of oil. You see it going up to $113 per barrel. Okay, that's normal circumstances, but let's look at this. What this shows is U.S. oil consumption, U.S. oil production. This is all adjusted so that we're talking about natural gas, oil, coal, and total consumption. It's all adjusted to tons or the equivalent for all three. That's why it doesn't look that familiar. Look what happens. Because the U.S. has declining consumption and rising production, that not only is it the case that by 2020, again driven largely by technology, that the U.S. will not import energy or primary energy, but will be a larger oil producer than Saudi Arabia if current trends continue. I don't know if the current trends are going to continue. But don't underestimate the ability of technology, as it was in the case of India, as well as in the case of oil today, to solve some problems which you think are insolvable. I always find it's bad news to bet against technology. And if you get a chance, and you doubt what I'm saying, go down to Luther Forest, right outside Saratoga, and take a look at what's going on down there at Global Foundries. Go down to Albany and take a look. This is Albany. Take a look at the Nanosciences Center. If you haven't seen it, you have to see it. And you'll walk away from there and you'll say, there is a lot going on. And if you want to go in there and see it, see the rooms in there where there's a lot of technology being created, I'd be happy to set it up for you. It is truly, truly remarkable. So, I don't know. You're right. My father, your father, I'm a congenital defect optimist, but I'm trying to get over it, but there's some really compelling, a lot of compelling things going on. The question is, can I fix Roger's oil bill? Can I get it to go down? No, and I'll tell you why I can't. I think that's pretty good, but you can see what the price has been doing on the right-hand side. That's just simply a reflection of the fact that our global consumption has been growing at a 1.2% rate, and global production, which has been managed very carefully by by OPEC, in part, is growing at a 1% rate. And so naturally, the price of oil reflects that by continuing to go up. It isn't really a mystery. This is true not only for this time period, but it's also true if you go back to, let me invite you all to BP Statistical Review. You can get it, it's free, it's on the BP website, just BP Statistical Review. You can get it on the web, you can print it, and you can see every number you ever could want to see on energy. And it's free, and you'll see exactly what I'm talking about. Its production is growing not as fast as consumption, and it's been managed. But things are changing, that's what I'm saying. Oh, look, these numbers have to be revised. You have to look at these numbers continuously. And to a large extent, it's statistics. It's driven by trying to put together everything in a nice, consistent package. It's very statistically driven.
It's beyond, it's just deep innovation, the innovation of some of our scientists.
There's a lot happening. There's no question a lot happening.
Just one more statement.
Yeah.
I've studied this for, not obviously, if you're living on this, the Arabs don't eat jiggers up, as far as I know. They know oil.
Yeah, they're not fools.
The Saudis are not, and the Arabs know that. Why aren't we taking advantage? We have watched the Chinese come in, buy the land, take the natural gas out of our land. The Australians come in, take the natural gas. A local business here saves $25,000 a month using natural gas. But yet Americans are still paying, as the gentleman said, $3.60 for a gallon of gas.
Yeah, I mean, there are so many problems we have. That's really good, and I hope you got this on television. There are a lot of problems, and I don't remember a time when there weren't, in my lifetime, I don't remember a time when there weren't just problems that would make you wilt. I don't ever remember this being a problem-free financial and economic environment. If anybody, well, maybe the 50s for a day or two, but that's about it. And I just, and there's no question that we have tough competition. You've probably seen the recent report from the IMF that the number one competitor, I know this makes me sound like a congenital defect optimist, but, and I'm pointing to things that are positive, but the IMF just did a very extensive analysis of productivity in all countries in the world, especially developed countries. The number one competitor in the world is the US. And that's taking into consideration everything that we know doesn't work, such as education. But the point is that we have a lot of technology driving a lot of innovation, and yeah, it's easy to get depressed about it, and I have no doubt there's problems. Here's another problem. Let me give you another one. That one. I said this to you 2 years ago, and I said this, I said, well, we're talking about raising taxes at the end of 2012, and we're talking about the sequester reducing spending because the deficits are alarmingly high and going even higher as a percentage of gross domestic product, and going even higher when you take total outstanding debt as a percentage of gross domestic product, is going to reach levels that were unsustainable. And I said, you watch. If the economy continues to expand, revenues are going to rise and expenses are going to go down and the deficit is going to go down. Here's the revisions between February of this year and May of this year. Yes, some of it is because of the increase in taxes. Yes, some of it is because of the rise in the payroll tax from 4.5% to 6.5%. But most of it is because of the improvement, and it wasn't even a robust improvement, in the US economy. Deficits are coming down, and they're coming down on their own, and they're coming down as a percentage of GDP, and they're reaching levels, they're getting to levels, and especially debt to percentage to GDP. Now, those of you that follow this stuff know that Reinhard Rogoff has said if debt to GDP gets to 90% or higher, this is controversial, it's going to be a problem. That's when economies start to lose their upward momentum or their growth rates start to decline. Look at these numbers. These are not my numbers. This is the Congressional Budget Office, the so-called independent objective scorekeeper, and most of my friends in Washington tell me they are independent and they are objective.
Going into the future, right? 2012 to 2018. Has anybody ever gone back 6 or 7 years to find out how the projections of 6 or 7 years work
yes.
out?
Yes. Yes. I go back to my chart. Well, wait a second. Let's see, we don't have to go very far. Well, we do. The answer to the question is yes, and that's the answer. You can see that every year, the projections either, or the forecast starts too high or starts too low and will trend towards the final outcome. It's always wrong. The Federal Reserve has done a study of their own internal forecasts and have concluded, I wish I had the quote with me, but have concluded that their own internal forecasts, as they put it in much more polite terms, have been wide of the mark.
And how can you make the projections?
Oh, I don't agree. Well, let's put it this way. It's the best you can do. It's the best you can do. What else are you going to do? I'm not going to do it. You have to start somewhere. And you have to make, look, it's an educated guess. I couldn't agree with you more. I couldn't agree with you more that my forecast for employment, my forecast for consumer spending, my forecast for short-term rates, my forecast for long-term rates are going to be wide of the mark. But if I just, and stock prices, but if I just get the direction right, maybe the economy doesn't grow 1.9% this year, it goes 1.6. Maybe it doesn't grow 2.7% next year, it goes 2. If I get the direction right, the cycle stays together. That's all I need. That's all I need. I'll never get the magnitude right. I mean, I have a, 12% average annual rate of return for the stock market between now and the end of 2014. The U.S., last year, I spoke to the Chamber of Commerce in Albany, New York. I do it every year. And they always, they don't always, but they did last year. They asked me, they said, how was your forecast last year? And I said, it was wrong. And for stock prices, and they said, what? It was, I was too low. It was came in at 12%, and I was at 9, something like that. And the only way I could finish my speech last year was say, I hope I'm wrong again. And so far, I am wrong. So far, the market has done much better. That's why I think the market might be a little pricey, overvalued, but that's just my guts or my instinct.
Okay. Speaking of that stock market, a lot of the gains that have been coming in have been gains on the bottom line because of efficiencies and laying off people yeah. and lowering expenses. You've had several disappointments coming in recently. You had Accenture today, which threw IBM.
I think everybody that I know looks deeply into the news, and everybody that I know knows the revenues are growing at a slow rate. And everybody I know, or most of the people that I know that it's largely because they're managing their margins and managing their margins effectively. And they know that can't go forever. And that's why I would forecast 3-5% growth in earnings this year and 2014. If the market's going to do well based on that forecast, and I couldn't agree more with you, if they're going to do better, I'd love to see the revenues rise and margins be preserved or even improved. But I'm not counting on that. I'm 3-5% growth in earnings. It's got to come someplace else. Now you're going to get me going because now I'm going to tell you where it's going to come from. Well, it's going to come from multiple expansion. No, seriously. Ed, seriously. If the stock market, I'm going to say something, John knows what I'm going to say. If the stock market if the stock market accurately reflected the level of interest rates, it'd be double what it is now.
Okay. If interest it rates doesn't go up, that's going to hit your multiples.
No, because I just said, the stock market has already discounted that. All right, you asked for it. All right, long-term interest rates. Look at the left hand. All right, consensus forecast. You think it's a mystery to anybody that rates are going to go higher? That's the consensus. All right, what does the consensus imply statistically for stock prices? Now, I apologize, this is a dividend discount model. For those of you that know dividend discount models, you know the problems with dividend discount models. But what it says is that if, I'll say it, and you sound like you know what you're talking about. So if rates go up, the discount rate, or the rate at which we're discounting dividends, is we're gonna have it go up as well. You follow me? So we're gonna have, it will impact. So using the consensus forecast and getting the discount rate from the consensus forecast implies that outcome for S&P 500, the S&P 500.
Can we tell the curve which matches?
Pardon me?
Tell the curve which matches.
What?
Profit is a profit.
Profit is a profit. It's a, it's a rose.
If that was the case, and I respect that, then MLPs would be a super buy.
Look, what I said before was important. I wouldn't give you one nickel for this forecast. The only thing I would say that's important is for you to ask yourself the question, is the message of the financial markets positive? Are the economic numbers positive? Does it look like we have further to go in the cycle? Because if we do, I'll have the direction right. I might not have any number right. And the odds are I won't have any number right. But I'll get the direction right. And if I can get the direction right, I'm going to be really happy. You ask me, well, you don't ask me, but you may ask me, what are you doing with your portfolios now? I'm just reflecting what I'm telling you. I'm saying that if a client has a target of 50% equities, fixed income, I'm at 57.5%. They usually only allow me to go to 65. I'm not at 65 because I'm worried about valuation. That's simply a reflection of what I'm telling you, is that I believe, this could change tomorrow, but it's not going to change tomorrow. Direction, that's the important thing, not the number. And I want to show you one chart. This is one chart which I really, really believe in. And this is one I want you to look at and think about and go away from here with it. That one. That's the BAA bond yield, because I wish I could have 10-year treasury. They don't go back that far. From 1919 until last week. Now, the reason I'm showing you this, is you had a long decline in interest rates or bull market in bonds that started back in 1924, lasted in 1949, actually a little bit, 1946. And then you had a bear market in bonds with rising rates that went from 1946 through 1982. Some of us remember it pretty well. In my view, see that hook at the bottom? In my view, a very strong case could be made that the decline in interest rates has ended, the bull market in bonds has ended, and we're about to start a long bear market in bonds. And if that's true, the only game in town, which proved to be the case the last time we had this, was stocks. Period of 1946 through 1970 was a very good period. Well, actually, even go further, right till today. It was a pretty good period for stocks. Stocks outperformed bonds. But the point being is it ushered in a very positive period for stocks. And of course, there aren't many people that believe that. It's not, again, I just honestly believe that it's a very good case could be made. That this is going to be the end of the period of a bull market in bonds and the start of a period of bull market in stocks. It's not to say that we're not going to get cycles along the way. From 1946, we had a recession and a bear market in 1954, 1957, 1960, 1970, 1974, 75, 1982, 1990, 2000, 2007, of course, the financial crisis. There'll be recessions and bear markets or cycles right along the way, and you got to be good at cycles. You got to be good at doing what we're doing right here. You got to be good at reading the financial market tea leaves and the economic tea leaves. You got to be good at that. You can't go to sleep. It isn't going to be a long-term bull market that you can go to sleep. You could go to sleep and you'll be fine. But the point being is that it's going to be, in my judgment, a time when equities are going to be a better place to be than bonds. I honestly believe that. No, it's not. That I'm going to tell you. I'm going to tell you that, whether you're with. No. You got to own stocks. You got to own more stocks. Now you have to do the cycle work, but no.
You want to think about that?
No, I don't want to think about that one. A balanced portfolio of 50% stocks and 50% bonds makes much more sense. I don't know you, I don't know enough about you, so I can't really answer the question. I don't know what your income needs are, and I'd have to know a lot more to be able to make a recommendation to you. And I apologize for saying something, but I think that you can easily own too few stocks. Certainly could since 2009, and I think for the foreseeable future. But you have to know how to do this. Okay? I've just been thanking you for all of what you've all said and you've contributed. I really appreciate it. I'm very happy you came here. I'm very happy this turned out to be more conversational and just back and forth, fire away. And so I'm deeply, deeply happy about that. That's made this really a fun session for me. I hope it's been a good session for you. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope you, as I started, I said, I hope you learned something. And as my aunt used to say, it's all part of life's rich pageantry. So thank you very much for coming.